Okay, so good morning, students. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we will be discussing about the next topic of these vector calculus. Okay, so till now we have discussed about the divergence and the curl, okay, as well as the gradient. So gradient of a scalar we have discussed, divergence of a vector we have discussed, and the curl of a vector we have also discussed. Now we will be discussing about the combinations. Okay, so a combination is also possible. That means a combination of both divergence and gradient can be performed on a scalar, as well as the divergence and gradient, as well as you can say the double curl, that means curl of a vector, is also possible. So those operations are actually can be applied, but in a particular different, you can say, equation. Okay, so that operator is called the Laplacian operator. So Laplacian operator is actually a single operator which is the composite of gradient and divergence operator. Okay, so suppose we are talking about the Laplacian of a scalar. So suppose V is a scalar field, and Laplacian is represented like this: del square V. Del square means it is the Laplacian operator. So any particular vector or a scalar is associated with del square. That means it is the Laplacian operator on that particular scalar or vector. Now when you are applying the Laplacian operator on a scalar, that will be different compared to the Laplacian operator on a vector. Why? Because vectors and scalars are different, have different properties. So Laplacian of a scalar is actually the divergence of gradient of the scalar. Okay, means if I concentrate on the scalar field, so Laplacian of a scalar is actually the divergence of the gradient of a scalar. So it means that, first of all, it means the divergence of the gradient of a scalar. So it will be, you can say, gradient of V, the first term. This one is the gradient of V, this one. This is the gradient of V, okay? So gradient of V, then the Laplacian, then the divergence of the gradient of V. That means, first of all, we will operate the gradient of V. What we will get? If V is a scalar field and we are performing the gradient of a scalar, then it results in a vector. Okay, it results in a vector, and V is a scalar actually. Now if it is a vector, then to that vector we can apply the divergence, because divergence is a dot product, because divergence is applied on vectors. Okay, so the gradient of the scalar will result in a vector, and the divergence of that vector is called the Laplacian, and it will be represented as del square V. Now, if I represent this particular equation in the Cartesian coordinate system, then the second term, the right hand side term, which is the gradient of V, you are familiar with this. This is called the gradient of V. Okay, and dot, this is the del operator. That means this will be dot product with this. That is the divergence of this. Okay, so if you apply the dot product, so the resultant will be double derivative of the partial, that means double partial derivative of V with respect to X plus double partial derivative of V with respect to Y plus the double partial derivative of V with respect to Z. Okay, so why so? Because if you perform the dot product, then the unit vectors of X and X will get dot product and it will be 1, and the unit vectors of X with other unit vectors will be 0, as you know. Now you can see that there is no out in the output, there is no unit vector. That means that it is a scalar quantity, and obviously it will be a scalar quantity. Why? Because you are applying the Laplacian of a scalar, which means gradient of scalar, that means vector, and divergence of the vector. Divergence is dot product, so divergence of a vector means a scalar. So Laplacian of a scalar gives you output to be a scalar quantity. This has to be kept in mind. The Laplacian of a scalar is a scalar. Okay. Now notice the Laplacian of a scalar is another scalar field. Now the Laplacian of V in other coordinate systems can be represented by transforming, because by transformation using the del operator, because this is the del operator which is represented in the Cartesian coordinate system. And this is the gradient of the scalar on the Cartesian coordinate system. Now, since in the earlier lectures we have already studied that the del operator in cylindrical as well as spherical coordinate systems, and also how to represent the gradient of a scalar in cylindrical and spherical coordinate system, we all know. So using those equations of cylindrical, that means del operator in cylindrical coordinate system, if we perform the same operation as we have performed in equation number 1, then we will get the Laplacian of scalar V in the cylindrical coordinate system. Same thing, if we use the del operator in the spherical coordinate system and gradient of V in the spherical coordinate system, and if you do the dot product, then you will get this as the output. This is the Laplacian operator of the spherical coordinate system. So same thing, just you have to transform. You have to use the del operator in the different coordinate systems, in cylindrical as well as the spherical. And if you perform this operation, then you will get the solution. Okay. So Laplacian of a scalar. This is Laplacian of a scalar. Now, if the Laplacian of a scalar is 0 in anyhow, suppose you have been given a scalar, and you are first of all you are finding the gradient of the scalar, and then you are finding the divergence of that particular vector which you've got from the divergence of a gradient of a scalar. So if you, that means in and all, if you perform the Laplacian operator of a scalar and it comes to be 0, that means we call that the Laplacian vanishes. The Laplacian of the scalar vanishes in that region. Because if it is 0, that means it has vanished. So Laplacian of a scalar vanishes in that region. So the scalar field is called to be harmonic. That means a scalar field, this may come in the MCQ form, that what do you mean by a harmonic scalar? That means a scalar field is harmonic if the Laplacian vanishes. That means Laplacian is 0. Okay. So that means the scalar is harmonic. Okay. That means it is a form of a sine or cosine. Okay, sine or cosine function. And this equation where the Laplacian of a scalar is 0, this equation number 5 is called the Laplace equation. It is called the Laplace equation. So Laplace equation is nothing but Laplacian of a scalar is 0. That is the Laplace equation, and which concludes that the scalar field is harmonic as it vanishes. As the scalar field is harmonic because the Laplacian vanishes in that region. Now Laplacian of a vector. How to represent the Laplacian of a vector field? Laplacian of a vector field is also a combination of divergence and you can say divergence, gradient, and also curl, but not directly as simple as scalar, because scalar field was quite simple, just gradient, divergence of gradient of scalar. But a Laplacian of a vector, the output is to be a vector. So if the output has to be a vector, then the equation is represented in a different way. Okay, so suppose A is a vector and you want to find the Laplacian. Now the donation or the denotion or the denotion on the description or representation of the Laplacian of a vector is very similar to scalar, just del square A. Means del square with any variable means Laplacian. Now you have to know that variable is vector or scalar. If it is a vector, then it is a Laplacian of vector. If it is a scalar, it is a Laplacian of a scalar. So Laplacian of vector is nothing but divergence, then gradient. That means gradient of divergence of A minus curl of the curl of A. That means double curl. That means the gradient of divergence of A. That means this is a gradient, and we are applying the gradient of the divergence of A. So gradient of the divergence of A minus the curl of A. Now A is a vector. Now gradient can be applied on a vector, a scalar actually, but divergence has to be applied on a vector. That is why if you compare the previous one, in the previous case where we have determined the Laplacian of a scalar, we have first performed gradient then divergence, because we have a scalar, so gradient has to be used, because we cannot apply divergence on a scalar, because divergence only applied on a vector. So that is why we apply the gradient first. So gradient of a scalar, which gives a vector, then we apply the divergence, then ultimately result is a scalar. Okay, in this case, since we have a vector with us, so we cannot apply divergence of a gradient. We have to apply gradient of divergence. So A is a vector. So if you apply the divergence of that particular vector, then it will be a scalar. And when it is a scalar, then you apply the gradient, then again it becomes a vector. Okay, that means this will result in scalar, and then gradient will result in vector. So again you will have a vector with you. Then minus of curl of A. Curl of A is a vector. Again you apply curl, because curl can be only applied on vectors. So curl of A is a vector, and again you apply curl, double curl. So we have a vector minus a vector, that means resultant is a vector. So resultant is a vector. Okay. Now it is quite it becomes quite lengthy, or the task become a cumbersome task. So if I show you, because in the Laplacian of a scalar, we have just represented how the equation looks like. Here also you can do the same thing, but if you take a huge, you can say time, but that means you can perform of your own itself, because it's quite easy, because you know how to perform curl. Okay, so if you want to represent the Cartesian coordinate system, so you take A as a vector and represent like this: ax, ay, az, ax unit vector x plus ay unit vector y plus az unit vector z. Okay, then you take the curl, and whatever vector you get in A, again you have to apply curl. Okay, then you take the divergence of A and then gradient of A, and then subtract it, and you will get another vector like this. You will get a vector like this, where the Laplacian of a vector A is nothing but the Laplacian of the vector A is represented in this way. Okay, just a representation. Okay, in Cartesian system. So just an introduction to you, what is a Laplacian of a vector. Now classification of vector fields. Now the main fundamental operations are the divergence and curl of a vector, because gradient is applied on scalars and divergence and curls are applied on vectors. Now if one tells you that a vector has divergence positive, what do you understand by that? Divergence positive means, we have already discussed earlier, that there should be a point from where the vector fields are coming out. That means it is diverging. And if it is negative, that means the vector fields are converging at a particular point. Okay, it is having a positive convergence or negative divergence. And the divergence is zero. That means a vector is like a point is there, and that particular point, it is not acting as a source nor a sink. The vector is just passing like this. So that means divergence is zero. So in that case, the divergence is zero. Okay, and here the divergence is positive, and in this case the divergence is negative. Okay, this we have already discussed in the previous lecture. Now curl also we have very recently discussed. Curl means the vector is traveling like this, and we have a closed surface, sorry, closed path. That means it is a axial rotation of a vector. So the ultimate vector will look like this, as if it is rotating, as if the vector is rotating in a clockwise or anticlockwise direction, whatever direction it is rotating like this. So if a vector rotates like this, that means we have a curl of a vector. The curl of a vector is positive. Okay, or it is a non-zero curl. And if it is like this, so that means the vector is also having zero curl. So that over this looks like that the vector is neither having a divergence nor a curl. The curl is also zero, and this is curl is non-zero. Okay, either positive or negative depending upon if you consider clockwise or anti-clockwise. Okay, now neither the divergence nor the curl of a vector is sufficient to completely describe the field. That means any field, any vector field cannot be described to be, you can say divergence is there, but what about curl? So both the things can be described simultaneously. Okay, a single description cannot be done. Okay, so you can say, that means the you cannot say that the divergence or curl is not sufficient to describe it in a you can say solely sufficient. So a vector field has to be described both by using divergence and curl. Okay, so how that will show you? Till now I have shown you that this particular vector field is having divergence, but I have not told about curl, whether it is having curl or not. So every vector field has to be described by both divergence and curl. Okay, that means every location has to be represented by latitude or longitude. Only latitude will not give you any result, only longitude will not give you any result. So you have to locate any particular point in the globe by using both latitude and longitude. That means a vector has to be described by both divergence and curl simultaneously. Okay, so in this case I have only represented for divergence. I have just described that it is having divergence, but I have not told whether it is having curl or not. In this case I have only told that it is having curl, but what about divergence? I have not told that. But in this case I have told that it is not having divergence, not having curl, both. That means both are zero. That means here I have described them both. So now I will be showing that what about this? This also can be represented by this vector field can have some, you know, input as, or you can give a judgment whether it is having a curl or not. So let us see some fields. Okay, this one. Now four vector fields are there, A, B, C, D. Now tell me, anyone tell me, in the A1, just we have seen just now. Okay, so A is having divergence zero. Okay, so you have already seen, so you have know, I have the idea that this is having divergence zero because it is not divergence, not converging to a single point. The divergence is zero. Also the curl is zero. Why curl is zero? Because it is not rotating. It is not rotating. Okay, rotation is not there. So for A, both divergence and curl will be zero. Now tell me, anyone, that for B, divergence is not zero because we are having some positive divergence, because the vector fields are coming out from a point. We can see that. But is the curl positive or zero? Or is it curl is non-zero or zero? Can anyone tell for B whether the curl is zero or not? Divergence is not zero, we have seen. We know that. But what about curl?
So curl is 0 for B.
Curl is zero. Why? Curl is zero because you can see from here, curl is zero. But why it is zero? Because what is curl? Curl I have shown you over here. See, curl means rotation. The vector has to rotate. The vector needs to rotate. So if there is no rotation, so that there is no curl. So the B is only having divergence. Divergence is not zero and curl is zero. Okay. Now for C, you can see for the option C, there is some rotation. So the curl is not zero. But there is no divergence because there is no particular point from where the vector fields are coming out or entering. Okay, there is no particular point. That is why the curl is not zero, but the divergence is zero. Just like this. This is having curl not zero, but divergence zero. But the fourth one, D, is having both divergence and curl. Why? Because from this particular vector, we can see that it is rotating. It is rotating like this. Because if I extend it, you can see it is rotating. It is having a rotational motion like this. And also it is coming out from some point. That means there is some point from which it is diverging out. Okay, so there is some divergence also. So divergence is not zero because there is some divergence and there is some curl both. So it is like a, you can say, if you extend them, okay, it looks like this. Okay. So it is a shape of a Cherky. So it is rotating as well as coming out from a point, both. That means the vector is having both divergence and curl. Okay. So they are non-zero. Okay. So if vector is represented like this, suppose K unit vector x, okay, so divergence is zero, curl is zero. If the vector is K unit vector r, okay, so divergence will result in a scalar and curl will be zero. So like this actually. So you can represent in this way. Okay. So now, since we have discussed about the one criteria, or you can say one criteria we have seen, that the concept of harmonics, that is the Laplacian of a scalar if it is zero, that is a Laplace equation, then it is called harmonic because the Laplacian vanishes. But in a vector field also, okay, suppose if you have a vector and if you perform the divergence of a vector, okay, then it is zero. That means it is not diverging. That means this one, it is not diverging. It is also not diverging. So if a vector is not diverging, A and C have divergence zero. That means it is divergence less. It is called a solenoid. So vector is also called a solenoid if the divergence is not, if di there is no divergence, that means divergence is zero. So vector is called a solenoidal vector if the vector is having no divergence. Okay, there is no point from which the vector is either coming out or entering. Such a field has neither source nor sink of flux. Okay, flux or vector. So from the divergence theorem, this is the divergence theorem. If the divergence is zero, that means the if this divergence is zero, that means the volume integral of divergence is also zero. And if the volume integral of divergence is also zero, that means as per the divergence theorem, the volume integral of divergence of A is equals to the closed surface integral of divergence of A, the closed surface integral of A. So if the divergence is 0, then the closed surface integral of A is also 0. That means if there is a surface which is closed from all four directions, okay, then the surface integral of that vector will also be 0. Because there is no point from where it is coming out, the vectors are coming out, so it will be 0. Okay. So a solenoidal field A can always be expressed in terms of another field F. That means a particular field, or you can say that means if a field is solenoidal, that means the divergence is 0, it can be represented by another field also, by another field F. How? Because if I say if divergence is 0, okay, then this closed, this one, this the surface integral, closed surface integral of A is 0, okay, and the F is a vector which is curl of A, okay. So any particular field, if the divergence is 0, it may not be that the curl is 0, the curl may be not 0, okay. So curl may be not 0. So if I consider the divergence is 0, so curl may not be 0, so it may have a curl. But if that curl is also 0, then the vector is called curl free vector, and it is irrotational. That means it cannot rotate. Just like this, this is a curl free vector, this cannot rotate, this is also a curl free vector, this cannot rotate. So just for the conclusion, a vector which is solenoidal, that means it cannot diverge. So this vector A is solenoidal vector, okay. Vector C is solenoidal vector. Vector B is irrotational because it is having curl 0, and vector D is not solenoidal, neither solenoidal nor irrotational, because it is having both divergence and curl. But a vector is both solenoidal and irrotational because it is not having divergence nor curl, okay. So these two terms must be kept in mind, because this comes in short courses or MCQs. The solenoidal vector means divergence is 0, irrotational means curl is 0, okay. So from Stokes' theorem, if curl is 0, so we know that the surface integral of curl of A is represented as the closed line integral of vector A, and if curl is 0, then this will be also be 0, closed line integral will also be 0. That is, a closed line integral 0 means it is not rotating. Any vector, if the closed line integral vector is like this and there is a line integral, okay, a line or a closed line, you are finding the line integral of a vector, how the vector rotates. If it is 0, that indicates that it is not rotating. It is not rotating because the vector line integral is 0, that means it is not rotating, okay. So that is why it is called irrotational. So the line integral becomes 0, so closed integral becomes 0 because curl is 0, because it is not rotating. So you can say that since it is, the line integral is 0, that is why it is not rotating, because if the line integral was positive, then it has to rotate. That means if it is rotating, then only you are getting line integral to be non-zero. But if it is not rotating, that means the line integral will be 0, hence the curl will be 0. So for divergence less, the closed surface integral has to be 0. For curl less or irrotational vector, the closed line integral has to be 0, okay. So thus, in an irrotational field, the circulation of A around a closed path is identically 0. This implies that the line integral of A is independent of the closed path. That means the line integral of A is independent of the closed path, so the vector is not bound to the closed path, okay. Therefore, an irrotational field is also called a conservative field. So A vector field which is irrotational is also called a conservative field. So there are two terminologies for that. Irrotational means conservative. So in general, the field of vector, the field of a gradient V, okay, the field of a gradient V is purely irrotational if the gradient, if the curl of gradient of V is zero. So in general, the field of a gradient is purely irrotational. That means if you take any scalar, if you perform the gradient of the scalar, okay, if you take the gradient of a, suppose this is a different case I am talking about. You take a scalar, you perform the gradient. Once you perform the gradient, what you will get? You will get a vector. And if you find the curl of that vector, then it will be another vector. But generally it is observed that whenever you perform the gradient of a scalar and then the curl of that particular vector, it is always zero because it is purely irrotational. Okay, then the vector becomes purely irrotational. It doesn't rotate at all. Okay, this is a observation. So in general, the field of a gradient V for any scalar V is purely irrotational since the curl of the gradient of V is zero. Got it? Okay, so this is another case. If the curl is zero, it doesn't mean that it is not a you can say divergence less, or if the curl is zero, then we can say that it is having a gradient. Okay, so it is the vector may be called as a divergence of a scalar field. Okay, so before going to the next topic, let me ask you, did you understand these four combinations or these four different cases?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, there is a theorem which is called the Helmholtz theorem. Okay. So, it comes in short notes often. So, Helmholtz theorem tells that a vector A is uniquely prescribed within a region by its divergence and its curl. That means any vector has a property, and their property can be they can be classified or can be represented depending upon this divergence and curl. That means a vector, what is the property of a vector? Means what is the characteristic of a vector? That vector has to be tested on divergence and curl, and how does it perform on the divergence and curl, then we get to declare the judgment of a vector. Okay. So if we suppose there is a vector A and it is having a divergence, that means it is having both divergence and curl, that is, it is neither irrotational, neither it is solenoidal. So it is having some non-zero divergence and non-zero curl. Divergence is rho V and curl is rho S. So rho V can be regarded as the source destination of A and rho S is the circulation destination. Source destination because if it is positive, that means it is having divergence. So there is a point which is a source from where the vector is emerging or diverging. Okay. So that is why rho V is called the source destination of A and rho S is the circulation destination because curl means it is circulating. So it is a circulation destination.
So density.
Oh, sorry, density. Sorry, density. Misread it. So, it is a density. Source density and circulation density. Okay. Because, yes, it is represented in terms of density because every vector means the range of a vector may not be limited to some area or a volume. Because a vector means it is like a wind, it is traveling from one place to another place. So, generally, what we do in electromagnetism also, if you have a magnet and if the bar magnet is having the magnetic field lines, then we know that field lines are carrying flux, but we generally put a area surface like this so that the flux per area gives you the flux density, because we want to measure in terms of density, because it is not possible to measure the entire flux. Okay, that is why we measure in terms of density. Here also, this is also one kind of divergence. The fluxes are emanating from a particular point. So therefore, we measure the density. So it is the source density and it is the circulation density. So any vector A satisfying this equation 13 with both rho v and rho s vanishes at infinity can be written as a sum of the two vectors, one irrotational zero curl and other solenoidal zero divergence. This is called the Helmholtz equation. That means any vector which is not having any divergence, not having any, because you can say it is having a divergence as a curl both, but still it can be written as a sum of the two vectors. It can be written as a sum of the two vectors where the two vectors are having zero divergence or zero curl. It is possible. It is called the Helmholtz equation. That means, not to get confused, suppose A is a vector, it is like this. This is A. We are told that A is a vector which is having both divergence and curl, but still it can be represented as a combination of two vectors in which one is not having curl and one is having not having divergence. Because if you combine them, then only you will get this. If you combine them, then only you will get this. Because this will not come in the picture, because since it is not having divergence nor curl, so no way this will contribute. But B and C, if you add, you will get D, isn't it? Obviously, by seeing the picture only, you can understand that if you combine them, you will get the this particular case. So if you want a vector which is having both divergence and curl, then you have to combine two vectors in which one vector is having divergence but no curl, and one vector which is having curl but no divergence. Then only you can get a both divergence and curl vector. Okay. So that is why it is told that any vector A satisfying this equation, that is with having both divergence and curl, vanishes at infinity. That means it is vanishing at infinity. That means it is having an infinite limit. So nowhere it is having zero divergence and curl. So it can be written as a sum of two vectors, one irrotational, that means one has to be irrotational, not both irrotational and solenoidal, only irrotational. That means the irrotational vector will have zero curl, but it has to have some divergence. And the vector which is having solenoid, no divergence, has to have some curl. This is called the Helmholtz equation, so the theorem. So this Helmholtz has described this theorem, that a vector A is equals to minus gradient of V plus curl of B. Because if you see this equation, if a vector A is having curl 0, then the vector A can be written as a divergence of a gradient of a scalar. The A is a gradient of a scalar. If it is not having any curl, so it can be represented as a gradient of a scalar. So this one is the curlless, zero curl. That means this one, zero curl. And this is the zero divergence, that is the irrotational one. So it is a having curl. So since it is having curl, it is represented as curl of B. Okay, so this is the Helmholtz equation. So this is the statement. This is the statement of the Helmholtz equation. And this is the equation of the Helmholtz equation. Did you understand this? Did you got this thing, this part?
So minus gradient of V कैसे है सर वो?
ये वाला gradient of V, क्योंकि ये देखो यहाँ पर लिखा है कि if you have a curl, okay, so if I talk about this one, if there is a vector which is having no divergence, then it is zero. Now if it is zero, then the closed surface integral is A is zero. Okay, now closed surface integral of A is zero. That means if it is having a curl, it is having a curl, so it is represented like this. Okay, it is represented like this curl. In this case, if a curl is 0, that means the curl of a vector is 0. That means the close line integral should be 0. And if close line integral is 0, that means it is having gradient. Why? Because if you can remember the gradient equation, the gradient equation was there, that the shortest length, okay, so that means you are jumping from one point to another point in the shortest length, okay. So that is why it is represented in this way. So if the closed line integral is 0, so it means that it is having some gradient, but it is a negative gradient, okay. This direct explanation is not required, okay, it is not given, because it is a mathematical deduction, it is not in your syllabus, okay, because this representation is not included in the syllabus, because it is a huge mathematical equation, okay, you can say derivation, but that is not required, just for the information that any particular closed line integral, if it is 0, that it represents that the it is having a vector, because obviously it is a vector, so vector will be having some minus gradient. Okay, it is a minus gradient. So that minus gradient is representing the curl to be 0. Okay, so this part is there. So associated with that, we have some numericals with us. Okay, this numerical is there. So it shows that a vector field A is conservative if A possesses one of these two properties. Let me show that a vector field A is conservative. Conservative means it is irrotational. That is, curl is 0. If A possesses two of these properties, that means a line integral of the tangent component, okay, this one, line integral 1, okay, and the line integral of the tangential component around the closed path is 0. Okay. So this is a similar kind of a numerical, okay, which is actually representing this part, which you are actually was discussing. Okay, it is kind of a similar kind of a example. Okay, I think it is almost time. Okay, so I will continue this particular numerical in the next class. It will be better for you. Okay, so I will continue in the next class. Then I think this confusion will be clear. Okay, so I will continue in the next class. Okay, so is it okay for you?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this divergence and curl portion is little bit, you can say, it seems to be confusing, okay, but if you practice the actual equation or solve them using the numericals, divergence and curl, then it becomes quite easier, because the calculation part is takes a little bit time, okay, but if you perform the calculation with, you can say, with concentration or minutely, then it will achieve you quite marks, okay, because it is quite scoring, okay. And most importantly, this part, this the Helmholtz equation is very much important. It comes in the exams, okay. And this part which I've just discussed, okay, that whether a vector is irrotational or whether it is solenoidal, okay. So this portion is also, it this kind of question comes in the short notes or in the MCQs. Okay, so this is very much important. So this is the basic things of the chapter of the vector calculus. These are the basics. Okay, so then we will continue in the next class then. Okay, so then you can leave now. So thank you.